Well, welcome, folks, to another BEC Online. It is great to have you with us again. My name is Paul Rogers. I'm the lead pastor here at BEC, and you really are very, very welcome. In today's time together, we have worship from Adam mainly and a whole host of other folks joining in with the band. And we'll also be continuing our series in Psalm 23. And for that, we've put together 23 stories across this series over the weeks. You're going to be hearing just short snippets of people from BEC of all shapes and sizes, backgrounds, and just something of their story. So we've got that to look forward to as well. Before we kick off, just a couple of things to say, if I may, a bit of housekeeping. Firstly, we have advertised, it will be on the BEC website, details may come up now, an operations team leader. We're very excited about this post, we feel it's very necessary. Someone to just make sure the whole operation of the church keeps running smoothly, help us with our strategic planning. So either if you think that is you or you know someone that might be interested, it's a part-time role, 3 days a week, do please ask folks to get in touch, get details, and we'd love to hear from them. And then just finally, as part of being in lockdown, our leadership team has been considering how might the next 6 months play out. And we're putting together, again, a series of short videos into one compilation that we're going to put on YouTube and on the website. And the idea is that folks can have a look at this. It will map out, like I say, the next 6 months for the different areas of the church's life. Folks can watch it. And then what we want to do is get together, make opportunity as clusters, our groups of small groups in the church, for people to come online, we'll Zoom together and just have a Q&A around what's been said. So more details of that anon. So as we begin our time together, why don't we commit ourselves to the Lord? Jesus, Shepherd of our souls, we just invite you now to come, present yourself with us. We love your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, I pray that you would be very real now, tangible to everyone watching, whether they're alone, with family, friends. God, would you presence yourself with us? And I pray that for many of us this morning, it would be absolutely unmistakable that we have met with God. So change us by degrees. Be with us now, and we will seek to give you all the glory as we live out lives laid down for you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hi, I'm Lily. I'm 13 years old and I'm part of the BEC Youth. Before today, I hadn't read Psalm 23, so when I did read it, I felt like it was saying that God will always be there for you, no matter what. As I read it a bit more, verse 3 really stuck out to me. The verse is, "He will give you new strength. He will lead you on the right path as he has promised." I think this is saying that God will stand next to you through hard times and give you the strength to get through them. Also, it's saying that God will always lead you on the right path, even if it means taking people out of your life or putting people in your life or just going through harder times. I also think this is quite relatable to me because when I was in year 5, I was only Christian at home and at church. I think this is because hardly any of my friends were Christian, so I felt like I had to not be Christian for them to accept me. I knew that what I was doing wasn't what God would have wanted me to do, but I was doing it anyway. You know, I would say God's name in vain, and I treated people in the way that God wouldn't have wanted me to. Really, I was just copying my friends because when you're 10 years old, being Christian isn't exactly the coolest thing to do. But you know, that's what I felt like I needed to do to fit in. Then I realised that actually that wasn't right and I needed to stop doing what I was doing. So I prayed about it and at first I didn't get any answers, which I wasn't expecting to. But I sort of just lost hope and stopped praying. And after a while, I started praying again because I knew that I really needed to stop. And that's when I noticed that I was stopping doing like little things. And it wasn't like an overnight thing where one morning I woke up and I was this perfect Christian, because I wasn't a perfect Christian and I'm still not a perfect Christian. But you know, just gradually I stopped doing what I was doing. And I felt like God had given me that strength to stand up for Him and stand up for myself. God also took people out of my life that I didn't need, and He put people in my life that I did need. My two best friends at the moment are both Christian, and they're just the most amazing people, and I feel like God put them in my life for a reason. We have talked about it before, and we all agree that actually we don't think it's a coincidence that we're all Christians and we all go to the same school, and we all think that God put us in our lives for a reason. That's how that verse relates to me, you know, that's how God has given me strength and led me on the right path. So I hope you have a nice rest of the day and a nice summer holiday, whatever you're doing or wherever you're going. Yeah, that's it from me. Bye.
Morning, my name's Simon. Psalms 23, what a wonderful psalm that has so much relevance and history that I can remember in terms of how God has been great in my life. Particularly, I think to the times when I walk through the darkest valley. So early in my Christian life, I'd just become a Christian in 2004. And in 2005, I had a burnout and a mental breakdown. Early on in my life, I'd just become a father, working too much, and it required that I took 9 months off work. We lost our home, and I was diagnosed with bipolar disorder. Obviously a very challenging time, and we were very lucky that attending Grapevine Church, I was anointed with oil. So the fact that God prepares the table before me in the presence of my enemies attacking my mind, the anointing of the oil on my head enabled me to be healed. Over time, I was able to rebuild my life. And it's just amazing to know that God has this promise for you, to know that He is able to give you rest. And through this testimony of knowing His grace, we can always come to God. So it's very special to me, my family, knowing that having been through these times, knowing there is darkness, there is always hope, and God will always be there, and we get to dwell in His house forever.
Face to face, I am yours, Jesus, you are mine. joy, perfect peace. Earthly pain finally will see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive, oh yeah. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. Happy day, I'll never be the same. Forever I have changed. Oh, what a glorious day. What a glorious way that you have saved. Wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Forever I am changed.
Follow you go. say, trust and obey. I will walk by faith and not by sight. God of my life. So let your kingdom come, your will be done. All your promises will stand forever. You're my defender.
Share with you a testimony about how God set me from depression and how He led me through the dark valley and was with me there. So it was about 10 years ago when I went deep depression. I had suicide thoughts. I planned how to kill myself. Just want to finish my life. I didn't see any sense to live. At the same time, my family, pastor and church, pray for me. And I remember one evening, I stay in my room, and I have this horrible thoughts, how bad I am, and that I shouldn't live. And I remember when God speak to my heart and say, I'm here in the dark moments with you. Just come to me as you are. Tell me about your problem. I want to listen that. I am not far away. And I remember I pour out my heart before Him. And I remember when He said, I call you to relationship with me. Just tell me every day how things going, and I want to help you. Depression is not from me and it's not my plan. And I remember that my life start change day by day. You know, I couldn't meet up with people. I stayed in my room for 3 years. I have a fear of people. And I hate myself. And I remember when I, you know, just God show me who I was and show me that he walked with me through the dark valley. I start to speak to people. I start to be open up, and he turned my life 180 degrees. Like, you know, he give me joy instead of sadness. And you know, now I have a fun with God, I say. Like, my life is completely changed. And I want to encourage you wherever you are at the moment. God didn't finish with you. He is over depression. And I know now we are on a season with this pandemic when mental issues is rise up. But God is above all. And I want to encourage you wherever you are. Come to him. He has a good plan for you. Plan about the prosper, a good life, not about depression and sadness. He has a joy for you. So God bless you. Have a good day.
Again. So we're going to continue now with our series in Psalm 23. It's probably the best known of Psalms. You may be watching now and not be a Christian, but may have heard this, perhaps particularly sadly at funerals. It talks about walking through the valley of the shadow of death and not fearing evil in that place even. That's not the verse we're going to look at today. Interestingly, in terms of searches, these six verses of this psalm are 6 out of 10 of the most searched Bible verses on Gateway Bible. And so I think we're dealing with something that interests us, that is close to our heart. And I want to ask quite simply this morning the question, are we led by God? Are we led by God? And let's have a look at the verses we're going to deal with today then. And it's verse 2. I'm going to read verse 1 first, though. It says this: "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters." Well, I wonder what comes to mind when you hear those verses. I wonder if this picture depicts what comes into your mind. Lush green pastures, perhaps plentiful rivers flowing there. A place where the sheep essentially can kind of be plonked down in the middle of the field and they just graze all day. All day breakfasts for the sheep. And like I say, plenty of water. I think many of us would quite like life to be like that. Many of us want our Christianity like that, where essentially our needs are guaranteed. Life comes without too much effort, and perhaps where we can just be fairly self-reliant. We're not dependent on a shepherd once we're in that good place. Well, the thing with that is this. It's not good for us. If we spend the whole day just eating, grazing, looking after our needs, whether literal or metaphorical, we are just going to become fat sheep. Immovable, probably a bit consumerist in our outlook. It's all about us and our needs. We're likely to become a bit apathetic and maybe a bit flabby and independent. Well, this picture isn't true, actually, to shepherding in the Middle East. We're told in verse 1, "The Lord is my shepherd." And Middle Eastern shepherds are constantly with their sheep. They're in very different terrain, as we're going to see, and they lead their sheep. And the sheep have to follow. The sheep are totally dependent on the shepherd. You see, when you look at the landscape, it's more like that than the slide we saw previously with the green grass. It was a barren landscape. Food was scarce. There was grazing, but the shepherds had to find that place. And actually, when it talks about the green pastures, the understanding at the time would have been just kind of tufts of grass here and there, that shepherds knew where to find them, but the sheep had to be led. In fact, Mark Twain, the American author, when he went to the Middle East one time, he said, "It's unusual. There is a breed in this place of gravel-eating sheep." Such was the outlook when he saw them eating. It looked like they were just eating the gravel. And it talks also, that verse, verse 2, about quiet waters are like this. The word means restful. There were restful waters. But again, even though there was water available, the sheep were dependent on the shepherd for finding that water in the valley bottoms, hidden away, tucked away under rocks, etc., a spring or something like that. And so again, the sheep just needed to follow the shepherd. So what this psalm is saying is this: we are dependent for provision, for safety on the shepherd. He has to lead, and we have to follow. So let me ask you, and maybe you just want to think about this as we listen now. Honestly, are you led by God? Am I? Truly? Am I really led by God? Is Christ really at the centre of my life? What evidence would I cite to prove that? If somebody said to me, "Paul, prove to me that you are led by God," I wonder what I'd say. I wonder what you would say. Is Jesus at the centre, or is our Christianity something of an addendum to the rest of our lives, an add-on? It's about our will. We've become perhaps independent sheep and we're going our way. We're a bit stubborn or willful. Or are we being led by God? The problem is, if we become independent, then sheep are likely to get lost. You know, it's not complimentary, particularly, that we're called sheep. Sheep can do daft things. They wander off, they get lost, they get entangled, and so become endangered. Is that where you find yourself this morning? Do you just have a sense you've wandered off somewhere? And you're looking and you're thinking, how did I end up here? I never expected to be here. Maybe you've got entangled, it's difficult, and even you're in danger. Or maybe you've just become a bit comfy, like that picture we saw of the somewhat overweight sheep earlier. Life's become a bit comfy. Sure, it looks good and you're thankful for what you've got. But long enough since the shepherd has moved on, and you just don't sense his presence like perhaps you used to. Well, in the rest of our time this morning, I just want to think very practically, how does God lead then? Maybe you're watching and you're saying to yourself, well, I'd like to be led by God, but how does that happen? Well, maybe there's some things here that can help you. And firstly, I want to talk about God when he leads specifically. There is specific leading. That is particular leading of God for individuals in particular situations. Now, I have to say, I do think sometimes as Christians, we can get a bit over-focused on this aspect. We're always after God's leading. God, what have you got for my life? What have you got for me? Where's this heading? Where's my career heading? What about my relationships? Geographically, where am I going to live? And we can just become a bit over preoccupied, a bit prone to self-orientation. Lord, I'm here. There's all this stuff in me. When will I be discovered, Lord? When are you going to do something in my life? That's the negative. Now, at the same time, these things can be important. there are significant decisions for us to make in life. How do we make them? Well, some of you may have come across the Alpha Course. And there's one session of the Alpha Course called How Does God Guide Us? And they give some headings that I'm going to go through in a minute. But I do just want to say this. The Alpha Course is designed for people who want to explore the Christian faith. And again, maybe you're watching now and you've been journeying with us for a few weeks. You're interested in this Christianity stuff, or maybe you're just coming back to faith. I really want to encourage you. The Alpha Course is a great way to unpack your questions, your thoughts in a very non-threatening way. A series of weeks, series of talks, and it's all available online now. So you might want to Google Alpha Online and you can find details, or get in touch with us if you're interested. And maybe we need to look, if enough people are interested, to running one ourselves. But anyway, there's a talk on the Alpha Course called How Does God Guide Us? And it goes through a series of headings as to little markers for us, wayposts to help us with guidance in particular situations. The alliteration is theirs, not mine, by the way. What are they? Well, firstly, there's commanding scripture. Many of us have known the experience of just, we're in a situation, we need God to speak. We open the Bible, we're reading through, and it just speaks to us. It's called the living word. I'm just going to go through these quickly because this actually isn't my main point this morning. Secondly, there's the compelling spirit, the Holy Spirit in us. We just have a witness that something is right. We have peace about it and we follow that lead. Common sense, you'll be pleased to know, we don't throw our brain away when we become Christians. The will of God usually, or certainly very often, is just common sense. Sometimes it isn't. Sometimes it defies reason, but it is often just common sense. It's also advisable to take the counsel of the saints, to talk with people who we trust, whose judgment has proven trustworthy over the years, and discuss our situation with them. And then finally, circumstantial signs. Circumstances seem to line up. And equally, when all of these markers kind of are falling into place, it could be a good indication that a certain course of action is the Lord's will for you. So like I say, you can Google that talk, How Does God Guide Us, for more on that. But that's not what I want to major on today. Those things are important, particular situations, specific leading. But what I want to speak about more this morning is God's general leading. Some of you may be at home there and are thinking to yourself, well, the problem for me is this. God never speaks. God never leads me. He never guides me. Well, I want to say this to you. He already has. He already has spoken. And I think this is the most important area of leading for us. Well, what am I talking about? I'm talking about when God leads us into building our lives on scriptural teaching, the Bible, on a daily basis. I don't mean they're just having a quiet time or doing your Bible reading, although I have to say I very much advocate that, if at all possible. Certainly shoot for it. I know that's tough, but I can remember times, you know, kind of sat at my kitchen table 6:30 in the morning when I used to teach, you know, trying to read my Bible, falling asleep as I was doing it. I think it pleased the Lord, and certainly it got me into good habits. But just really that taking scriptural teaching day by day. And so this is being led by the Word of God on an ongoing basis, day in, day out, and letting the Word of God shape all areas of our lives every day. Let me tell you, this will lead you to green pastures. This will lead you to restful waters. If you build your life upon the Word of God, you will find yourself in a good place and your life will be fruitful. Psalm 1, it's my favorite psalm probably, tells us this. It says, "Blessed is the one whose delight is in the law of the Lord and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season." You just can't help but be fruitful. A life where your life is delighting in God's word, obeying it, submitting to it. You just can't help but bear fruit. "Whose leaf does not wither, whatever they do prospers. Jesus said a similar thing in John 15. He said, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, that is, if you live according to my word, if you're trying to imbibe it, just understand what it says, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. So are we delighting in God's word? Is God's word, the Bible and its teachings, a delight to us? I understand it's tough to read. And we can help you with that. I'd be only too happy if you want to get in touch to just unpack, well, how can I start reading the Bible? Where do I go? What does that look like? We can put resources in your hand. But we'd love you to become a person who delights and remains, lives according to God's word. So this general leading, let me just unpack that a bit more. Somebody has said this, if you sow an action, you reap a habit. If you sow a habit, you reap a character. If you sow a character, you reap a destiny. Most of our life is lived habitually. We just get into regular habits. And I have to confess, I am a little bit nerdy about my routines. I could talk you through my morning routine. I get up, I go down, put the kettle on, let the dog out, do my back stretches, go back, make my tea, go through, have a quiet time, da-da-da-da-da. All of us have got little routines like that. We live life habitually in all sorts of areas of our lives, our relationships, our family, our schooling, our work. We get into habits. What this saying is saying, and I agree with it, is this. Destiny, your and my destiny, is not shaped mainly by major decisions or by our particular talents and abilities, important though they are. Our destiny is shaped by acting wisely, day in, day out, by developing godly character moment by moment. Well, what does that look like? Explain that to me. Well, parents, do you want your child to be spiritual? I've come across most Christian parents, I think, want their child to grow up as a Christian. Well, let me tell you, that won't happen by getting them to Soul Survivor one particular year, or if only they can hear that speaker at church on that Sunday. Rather, it's through you as parents living out Deuteronomy 6. It says this, these commandments, God's word, that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. What's that saying? That your faith, parent, has to matter to you, and then you have to convey it. It has to matter to you that your children become Christians day in, day out. Talk about faith. Pray with them. Share with them at meal tables. Pray with them before they go to bed. Don't let Sunday be an option. In your house, is Sunday an option? Do your children see you committing to a group of believers, perhaps in the form of a life group? Or is it a kind of take it or leave it? And even worse, do we badmouth what's going on amongst the community of faith? I've said it before, and again, it's so true. You can fool a fool, you can con a con, but you cannot kid a kid. Your children know if faith is important to you. And if it's not, you're going to struggle to raise them up as Christians. So it's day in, day out. It's godly character that leads your children into, for example, green pastures. Let me rattle through a few more examples. What about financial security? We want to be led into financial security. Well, again, it won't come through specific moments, some get-rich-quick scheme or some particular job that pays really well. But I want to argue it will come through living according to Scripture, submitting your finances to God, doing all you can to avoid rash, going into debt, that sort of thing. Living generously, and again, giving. It costs. It does cost. It's tight. I was talking to someone only recently, a young adult setting up with a new place to live in and getting married and a budget and all of that. And they said, and I'm going to tithe. And they kind of winced. They were going to do it, but they knew it costed. Again, is giving to the Lord optional? Well, our children see that. God sees that. Many of us have a testimony. We have never outgiven God. Do we want to prosper in relationships? Do we want to live in green pastures in this area? And this includes romantic relationships. Well, again, it's not relating to that person. If I can only get that person as a friend or get involved in a relationship with that person. It's more about becoming a person that others want to commit to. Becoming someone that others want as a friend. Developing godly character, reliability, kindness, generosity, day in, day out. The Lord will look after you then, you know. And I want to say as well, if your heart's desire is to find someone, well, become the sort of person that God can trust with living life with someone else, can entrust someone else to. And then finally, what about career fulfillment, satisfaction? Barak there, he looks satisfied in what he's doing. Again, career fulfillment, I don't think comes just in getting that job, that particular job at that particular time. But rather it's day in, day out, proving your character in the workplace. Let me tell you, friend, God knows how to promote you. I felt that's a word for someone. Again, perhaps you're struggling in your career. You're not sure where it's going. Don't be necessarily looking at all the vacancies out there online, but prove yourself. Stay where you are. Get your head down. God knows how to promote you like no one else. So where has God got you? I want to encourage you again. Prove faithful where you are. Build your life on His word in all aspects of your life. Try and understand what Scripture says. I have to say, it probably does mean that you'll need to read your Bible, maybe read a few books on be it parenting or finances or relationships or whatever it is. There's plenty of stuff out there to have a look at. But let the word of God be your guide. As Psalm 119 says, your word, let His word be a lamp to your feet and a light for your path. And then finally, just in the time I have left, God leads by discipline. God leads by discipline. He arranges circumstances sometimes to shape us, to lead us. Doors shut, situations change. And at times it can feel like the shepherd's rod. I love this picture for some reason, just as gleeful. I think he's from Tajikistan, shepherd. But he's got a shepherd's rod there, just that kind of little stick there, just to make sure, just every now and again, to check the sheep are following, are going in the right direction. And there are times when God has to orchestrate circumstances, and it can feel difficult at the time because He's a work to do in us that is too deep for us to work out for ourselves. He's got to bring things to the surface. Maybe in this season, things have been coming to the surface you didn't realize were there. And God's orchestrated situations to bring this to the surface. Or maybe He orchestrates circumstances because we've been willful or stubborn, and He just needs to lead us in a certain direction. Have you noticed this? God allows us to go through stuff. But it's for our good. He's refining us. He's shaping us because He is a loving shepherd. Proverbs 3 says this, "My son, do not despise the Lord's discipline and do not resent His rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those He loves as a father the son He delights in." Are you going through stuff now? I think Corona potentially is the Lord's discipline. I don't think it's judgment. but I think he's shaping us. I think he's reorientating our priorities. He's showing us what's important in life again. Families, community, relationships, the environment. We're seeing these things again. And perhaps some of us are saying, we don't want to go back to where we were. I don't want to go back to that madness, that frenetic energy. What was I chasing? What was I after? I can't go back to that. Well, maybe the Lord's disciplined us. He's steered us through everything we've been through. So in all of this, if we follow him, if we follow his leading, whatever form it takes, I promise you, you will come into provision. It may not be everything you want, but it will be everything you need. You'll come into safety, security. He'll work on your character. He'll give you a sense of identity. You'll know him as a loving heavenly Father. You'll find yourself resting by still waters. So let me ask you to finish. Honestly, are you being led by God? Just in the quiet, just listen to the questions I'm going to put to you and see what the Holy Spirit says. Who's in charge? Who's leading? Whose will are you submitting to? Is it yours? Do you know deep down that probably you're a bit of a stubborn sheep? And has it got you into trouble? Do you find yourself a little bit lost listening to this? I want to encourage you. Jesus says, "My sheep know my voice." Has God been speaking to you today? Do you need to follow him again? What do you need to do? How do you get back on track? Do you need to talk to someone? A Christian friend, maybe someone you know. Feel free to get in touch with us if we can help. Lord, I pray, help us to be men and women, young people, who follow you, who realize their utter dependence on you for leading. God, I pray, let us not be stubborn. Let me not be stubborn. Prone to wander, oft I stray. I confess it. Soften us, Lord. And may we follow your leading into green pastures and beside restful waters. I just sense as I'm finishing here, and I'm just going to step out and say this. I just sense there's somebody this morning, you are troubled. You're really troubled this morning. I don't know what it is, but I just sense you're not in a good place at all. And the Lord is the answer. The Lord wants to be your shepherd. And you've been here before, but you need to yield. You need to submit. I want to encourage you, please get in touch. I'd love to hear from you. Maybe there's someone you know, a Christian friend, maybe at BEC Church, it may be somewhere else. Get in touch with them, but humble yourself. Don't hang on to your pride, please. And may we all know his wonderful shepherding of us. In Jesus' name, amen.
My shepherd, I'm the wolf. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul. And I will trust in you alone. And I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me on. He guides my way.
Your breath in our lungs,
cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will